an Ironic Media production.
Visit us at ironicmedia.com.
If I'm going to a fundraiser where there's a lot of people and a lot of standing, it's not a bad idea to have a stick, because if they're serving cocktails, the chances are you're a little wobbly and people think that you've had too much to drink.
Right.
I'd rather have them realize I'm sober and that I need a stick than think that I had too much to drink early on. And my younger brother carried a letter from his doctor in the car. So the, in the event he was ever stopped for running a stop sign or something like that, and they said, okay, you got to walk the white line, he had an excuse why he couldn't do that. He had a written letter from his doctor saying, no, I haven't been drinking, but if you want me to walk down that line, it ain't going to work.
Hello, everyone. This is Chris and Lizzo.
We are a brother-sister team.
And on behalf of the Charcot-Marie Tooth Association, a.k.a. CMTA, we are coming at you.
Coming at you from coast to coast. I live in California, and Chris lives in freezing Vermont.
That is right. And this is another fantastic episode of our famous podcast named what, Lizzo?
It's called CMT for Me.
That's right, folks. CMT for Me. What is it? A comprehensive podcast covering all aspects of CMT, the voice of individuals living with CMT, their challenges, and more importantly, their inspirational stories. We also cover research updates, fundraising, interviews with the CMTA community, which includes board members, branch leaders, CMTA leaders, and overall, an opportunity to spread awareness through the eyes of those with CMT.
Man, that's a great intro, Chris.
I know it is, Lizzo. I know.
That's a great intro, Chris. And I've received, I have received some great feedback from our listeners and our friends at the CMTA. Do you know that this podcast has been downloaded over 3,000 times?
Whoa, over 3,000. And we've only just begun. Well, I'll give you some feedback why I think that is. Most of those are my friends who want to hear my voice. I have an awesome podcast voice, and that's what's attracting our listeners.
Oh, my God. Let's just move on. I knew you would say that. So before we introduce our next guest, I want to tell you that I've been on a hunt for a new car. I know it's hard for me to get a new car, and I'm finally going out.
Very tired of this dialogue. You've been searching for a new car for years and years and years.
I know, but I'm really comfortable. I have this Mercedes that I got, and it's a 2006, and I just love it. And it's easy to drive.
Yeah, it's easy, but it's dangerous. Let's go through the details. Your horn doesn't work. The windshield's cracked. You have to add oil once a month. When you look in the back seat, and you start the car, right? It sounds like machine guns going off for 5 seconds. It's interesting. You have no back hatch, which doesn't even close. And I could go on and on. And I do recall, Lizzo, do you remember that time you pulled up to get gas?
Yeah.
And you left the nozzle in the tank and drove off.
Now,
and
listen,
it ripped the whole side of the vehicle. That was cool.
More people do that than they admit. I tell you, I've talked to other people. They said, I haven't told anybody, but that's happened to me too. But don't get me wrong. Like, I need a new car, but I have some foot issues and shortened calf muscles. So it's hard to find a car I can drive comfortably. So I'm forcing myself to go out and try these cars that are beautiful, but they just don't feel like my nice little car that I've had.
The one thing is, you are persistent. You'll not give up. And that's a great trait to have. And I'm really proud of you pursuing the endless hunt for a new car. Not everyone has such determination.
Well, I know a lot of people in the CMTA community, and people with CMT are full of determination and persistence.
Yeah, and it does take many shapes and forms. Some folks are given a challenge. They refrain from taking on these specific challenges. Then all of a sudden, bingo, there's a form of positive energy takes over, and the levels of determination are off the charts.
I hate to say it, but you're right.
Of course.
But this is an incredible lead-in for our next guest, someone who is courageous and persistent. This person will not let CMT run his life. And given the challenges of even getting an accurate diagnosis was hard, but he's been determined to overcome any obstacles that get in his way. He lives life to the fullest.
Wow. I'm really excited. Who are we interviewing, Lizzo? Superman?
You got it. It's Superman. No, it's Super Tom DuPont.
Nice.
So today we have Thomas DuPont
as our special guest for our podcast. And Tom has been chairman and publisher of DuPont Publishing since 1985. He has served his Tampa Bay community with distinction by holding so many positions with an almost endless list of associations and organizations. Just for example, including the former chairman of the Tampa Chamber of Commerce Tourist and Convention Council, or the chairman emeritus of the Board of Trustees for St. Paul's School, or even a member of the Board of Trustees of the Florida Aquarium Foundation. This guy's done it all. Mr. DuPont is a passionate car enthusiast and collector, and he's also an avid sailor and enjoys his time on the water in Florida and in New England in the summer. He and his wife have three daughters and seven grandchildren, all who live in Florida. Today, I'd like to welcome Mr. Tom DuPont.
Here we go. Tom, thanks so much for being on the podcast today. How you doing?
Well, I'm doing just fine, thank you. It's my pleasure to be with both of you today.
Awesome.
And further the cause for CMT.
I'm thinking, Tom, as we started, right, if I can recall, I think you sent an email to Lizzo and myself about wanting to be on the podcast. And so there's a lot to talk about here, but just in general, as an opener for our listeners, why do you want to be on today's podcast?
Well, I read the story behind your podcasts and why you were doing them. And I listened to one of the podcasts and I said, what they're trying to do is help other CMT victims, for lack of a better term, patients, or recipients, live a better and healthier and more enjoyable life. We're all going to get old and nobody's going out of here alive. And it's how you live your life that's going to give you the most pleasure. If you have a CMT, you've got limitations, but you can keep pushing those limitations down the road. If you want to call it kicking the CMT can down the road, that's what it is.
I'll tell you, those are very, very positive and inspirational words.
Tom, you know what I found fascinating? Let's go way, way back before you were born. Your mother and your mother's sister are identical twins, right? And they both have CMT. So already, only one in 250 births are identical twins, which is 0.45% of the global population. So that's already rare in itself, right? And then to have twins, identical twins, both with CMT is like an amazing story. I don't know if anybody has ever like researched that, but that's kind of incredible.
Well, by the time we went on the hunt to see if we'd get a diagnosis of CMT, both my mother and her sister had passed away. So we couldn't get 100% accurate diagnosis of them having CMT. Well, it was very clear to me in the last years of their lives, they were elderly. They died in their 80s, but they were very tentative and walking, moving, generally moving around. They both led active lives. Neither one was an athlete, to say the least. It became apparent that maybe they had CMT symptoms. We just didn't know what that was then. So when we started to investigate through a consultant, what was the problem here? And we knew that a couple of us in my side of the family had motor difficulties. We ended up being referred to Dr. Shai up at the University of Iowa. And when we went there in December, nobody would go to the University of Iowa in December. It was cold.
Tom, I went to Detroit in February. I don't know if that trumps that, to see Dr. Shai when he was there. So that was freezing.
I was worse. So there were five on our side of the family, my two brothers, two sisters, and myself. And on the other side of the family, we had three first cousins, children of my mother's identical twin. So needless to say, Dr. Shai and the scientists looking at CMT thought this was the best petri dish they'd ever seen.
There you go.
To see if we could establish that there was the same symptoms on both sides of the aisle, if you will. Mm-hmm. My younger brother and sister and I tested positive in that reflex testing that you do to determine that you have some motor deficiencies, as did two of the cousins who were there.
And Tom, just the time frame, how old were you and when was that?
That was in December of 2012. And so whatever that is, 10 years ago.
Yeah, so only 10 years ago.
Yeah. So I was in my early 60s at that time. And I had known that I had some motor deficiencies. I used to run a lot, not marathons, but 5Ks, 10Ks, and 2 miles and 1 mile and all that kind of stuff. And I noticed when I would step on something that was uneven, my balance would go away right away. And by the time the message got from my feet to my brain that I was falling down, and my brain went back to my feet and said, you better move your foot, I was already on the ground.
So wait, I have a question, Chris. So you didn't know you had CMT till you went to see Dr. Shai. You just knew there was an issue, something going on.
And we were using a healthcare consulting firm that was backing us up on various items. My older sister, who does not have CMT, had a bout of cancer, and she wanted a professional standing by her side at every step of the way. So we just extrapolated them and said, what are we doing? Because my younger sister and brother were much more advanced, and they are 8 and 10 years younger than me, 5 and 8 years younger than me. So if I was in my early 60s, they were in their mid 50s, and they were clearly having problems and starting to think about wearing braces on their feet and that kind of thing. So it took Dr. Shai a while to find the mutant gene that applies to our level of CMT. And that diagnosis was in June of 2013, when we got an official letter saying, you have a mutant VCP gene. It's hereditary because three of you in one side and two of you in the other side have the mutant gene. All five of you have the symptoms of CMT and motor deficiencies in your legs, and maybe some in your hands as well. And the other two that don't have the mutant gene are fine. I mean, they're getting old. They're my older brother and sister. They're just getting old.
So I'm trying to go back in time a little bit. In terms of, as you referenced, you were a runner, you noticed some issues. When was that? Was that at a young age, or was that something when you were in your 20s or 30s? But when did you first start to notice that symptom? And then it sounds like you just kind of lived with that for a long period of time.
Well, hard to say exactly. Probably the biggest amount of running I was doing was when we started the magazine company, from about 1985 to 1995. So I would have been in my late 30s then.
Yeah.
And that's when I noticed running, that every once in a while I just would be on the ground.
Yeah.
I said, it's just, everybody always say, yeah, skinny, weak ankles. That's all it is.
Right.
Well, it was very slow progressing. Thankfully for me, the CMT progression has been very slow. I may have slowed it down some more, but it hasn't been as rapid as my siblings.
Well, right. Let's talk about that. I think
that's an interesting point, right? Mm-hmm. There can be a symptom which may not be as severe, which doesn't trigger someone to seek attention, and they might live with that for 10, 15, 20 years.
Tom, why do you think your progression is not as fast as your other family members that you are with?
Well, you know that when you talk to the people and the research people with CMT, it never applies to anybody evenly. Some people later in life, some people earlier, some people faster, some people slower, some people their feet, then their hands, some the hands, then their feet, et cetera. So you don't really know where you are on that scale. But the idea that I subscribe to and try and live up to is to do what I can to prevent the progression from going at whatever its natural pace is. Mm-hmm. And if that means it's going very slowly and I keep it going very slowly, that's fine. But if I'm being active and doing the things that I do where it would be faster and I'm able to level it out a little bit, I'll do that. And by the way, it's a good idea to live a healthy life anyway.
Yeah, totally. And then I don't know if we touched base, but what type of CMT do you have, or were you diagnosed with?
I think it's, I know it's a 2.
Was it 2A?
Might even be 2X.
Yeah.
Because of the VCP gene applied to nobody else at the time it was discovered.
So you keep a really active lifestyle, though. And I remember you really focusing on that when we spoke to you earlier about a month ago. And you said that you think that, if I recall, you said that you think your activity level has something to do with you being on top of this progression and being able to stave off progression.
I think you need to recognize what it is that's deteriorating and then go right to the point and literally try everything. I have the resources that I've tried a lot of things, some of which haven't really worked.
So what's worked? What hasn't worked?
Well, everything that I do has to qualify as worked somehow, because I'm still here and it's progressing slowly. But I've had all kinds of braces and brackets. I've seen acupuncturists. I've seen the chiropractor, the stretch therapy, regular therapy, massage work. The chiropractor, and that's an interesting side that figures in on CMT and how to make sure that whatever's happening is happening as slowly or as quickly in this case as possible. I work with an upper cervical chiropractor, less damaging than the guy who slams your back and that kind of stuff. Mm-hmm. They just adjust your neck. And I started to feel like I was walking better. My gait was better after a few adjustments. And I thought, I just looked at the doctor and I said, well, why is it making my legs better? And she said, well, two answers to that. First is, do you remember Christopher Reeves? And I said, oh, sure, Superman. So what happened to him? I said, it fell off a horse and broke his neck. And right. said, what didn't work? I said, his legs. And she just looked at me and I said, okay. Right. She said that the deal is with the nerve stimulus going from your muscles up your brain and back, it goes through your spine. And if your spine's out of whack, it's like a bunch of swinging doors that bang into each other. If you get your spine aligned properly, the doors open and close and open and close, which means whatever message you're getting is getting to your brain and back, and you're able to compensate and work the muscles better. So that was kind of an interesting thing to me, to be working my neck. I did a lot of work over a long period of time. Now I just do once a month to go check in, or I do something foolish. I get to go see a few days. The adjustment of your upper cervical spine is mild compared to the one that crushes your back. I did have L5 S1 surgery on my disc that was giving me terrible sciatica, and they did a magical deal called a microendoscopic discectomy. And they essentially closed it up so that the disc couldn't leak out anymore. And now I'm a little stiff. I have a narrower disc and a little sensitive down there, but boy, not like it used to be. But once again, trying to line that spine up from top to bottom to get the message one way or the other.
Right. It's just interesting to hear you talk because it feeds right back into the start of our podcast, which is persistence. You have seeked out all of these, whether it's treatments or opportunities to do what you can. You've really been in the driver's seat to do what you can to kind of, as you reference, quote, kicking the can of CMT down the road, which I think it's incredible. You've been very, very active in life. And do you recall how you felt once you got that letter that said you had CMT? Was there any moment of disappointment or, hey, I finally know what I have? And did that drive some encouragement to move forward and shape kind of who you are today?
Well, I had plenty of symptoms leading up to that. They were somewhat mild, but plenty of symptoms. But when the letter came through, I guess, first off, I was, maybe this isn't the right for broadcast, but I was pretty pissed off.
It's totally fine. That's a common response. Sure.
And then my second reaction is, okay, I need to learn a little bit more about this so I can deal with it. Incidentally, I did toe over brackets around my foot that come up, the ones that come up the back of your leg, the ones that come up the front of your leg. They have a solid plate under your foot that goes in your shoe. When I was traveling for the magazine, I found that to be uncomfortable to have my feet locked in that position. I was on my feet all day at a car auction on concrete and pretty sensitive. I discovered one thing that I thought, and I get a little bit of trouble sometimes with this from my opinion, that because my foot was stuck, I didn't get any exercise of those muscles. They didn't move. So I came to the conclusion that there was more atrophy going on, more possibility of atrophy going on. So I got rid of those. I got other braces. I got some of the equipment.
Oh, you too.
So what is that? Is silicone?
It's like a neoprene silicone boot that goes around your foot. You strap it on, goes in your shoe. You put this on. It allows you a little flexibility back and forth, but it keeps your ankle from rolling over. I wore these for years when I was doing car shows.
So what Tom is showing us is a silicone sort of like sock with a boot without the toes. There's Velcro on it. Do you know what those are called? Are those called SAFOs?
They silicone, might. Hanger orthotics and stuff. You have to have your foot in a mold and all that kind of stuff. They fit it and they grind it down. So these are old. I used these for a very long period of time. And then they're hot.
They look comfortable, though. They're not plastic.
Pretty comfortable. See the high arch here?
Yeah. Listen, it does remind me, just to give a visual for our listeners, it's like imagine putting on, a ski boot or a hiking shoe, but it doesn't have the toe. So obviously there's more materials with Gore-Tex and things like that, but this looks
very important to leave your toes plenty of space. And incidentally,
interesting.
Be careful. Make sure your shoes are big enough, maybe a half size bigger. Buy the wide ones so that no matter what, your toes can move.
So these are available on the open market? I mean, who sells them?
Yeah, you have to go to an orthotic
guy. Go to an orthotic. Okay.
I believe they're called SAFO, S-A-F-O. Do you wear those now?
No.
What do you wear now?
What I wear now are two braces. This one.
Okay, that looks like a carbon fiber AFO.
This is called an extreme extern. EXTERN by Turbo Med.
Oh, Turbo Med. Turbo Med. Very okay. well known in our community. They're best. Yep.
Outside your shoe, it doesn't go in and irritate your shoe or the bottom foot. There's still some flexibility here. So when you're walking, you can get up on your toes and lengthen your gait. Straps on nicely, easy to get on, easy off. Where I am in the summertime, I'm on dirt roads a lot. This gives you tremendous stability so you don't roll your ankle when you step on a pebble. And it allows you to lengthen your gait, which is really important to stretching those muscles out.
So it's on the shoe you wear, so then you have the breathability component, et cetera. Exactly. So
it fits any shoe. You just have to follow the direction. And these you see all over the internet. And so it's one of the things where I went on the internet and actually got something that was worthwhile. These are straps that go around your ankle and strap around the ankle and come up the side. And they help hold your ankle rigid. So you again, the rolling your ankle doesn't. Your problem give you plenty of flexibility, your toes open, your heels open, goes down around your arch and comes up and keeps that foot level and prevents it from turning side to side.
So that's a brace
nuts.
Yeah, you've got your toolbox of braces there. So
yeah. So do you know what that's called, Tom, for our listeners?
I might be able to email you the name. I have
that's fine.
And you look at ankle bracelets, it'll come up.
Chris, I have a question for Tom because Tom is very, very successful. Very successful businessman. He's well established in the community. People know him.
So they know when Elizabeth, when we give Tom positive comments, he refrains. He has a little smile, but you can tell he's not real comfortable talking about himself.
Well, what I'd like to know is a lot of very successful people in our CMT community will not talk about their CMT. And I think it's fantastic that you're coming out there. For whatever reason, they don't want to talk about CMT. They don't want to show their braces. They keep to themselves. What is it that lets you go about society? I'm sure you get questions. I don't know how you answer them about what's wrong with your legs, what's wrong with your feet, but you don't feel embarrassed about it. You're like, this is who I am. This is what I'm doing. And I'm going to continue on living. Where does that philosophy come from?
And Al, just to carry on, it ties right into a question I also wanted to ask. When you were first started putting on braces and just those type of things, a lot of people refrain and they don't want anyone to know. And like Elizabeth said, tell us about the transition. It's a great question, Lizzo.
Well, you have to have a good dose of humility. That would help you get over the fact that you're wearing braces or something like that. The single most embarrassing thing that can happen, and by the way, I forgot one more gadget I use. I use collapsible walking sticks all the time.
You do?
If I go to a stadium or an event where I have to go up and down steps and stand up where the seat in front of you is about ankle height and you're wobbling a little bit, if you've got a stick to hold on to, and when I'm walking with those extern brackets, I use the sticks. It also helps me with my cadence, get my hands out there. But I'm slowly growing up to the realization that if I'm going to a fundraiser where there's a lot of people and a lot of standing, it's not a bad idea to have a stick, because if they're serving cocktails, the chances are you're a little wobbly and people think that you've had too much to drink.
Right.
I'd rather have them realize I'm sober and that I need a stick than think that I had too much to drink early on. And my younger brother carried a letter from his doctor in the car. So in the event he was ever stopped for running a stop sign or something like that, and they said, okay, you got to walk the white line. He had an excuse why he couldn't do that. He had a written letter from his doctor saying, no, I haven't been drinking, but if you want me to walk down that line, it ain't going to work.
Right. Yeah.
So how do you feel about CMT talking about it? Do people ask you questions? Do you feel offended?
I offer up the solution first. If I don't know somebody, if I'm out playing golf and I'm someplace with strangers or something like that, I just look at them. I say, you're going to have to give me, I'm a little bit slower on the walking here. It takes me a little bit more time to get my feet on the ground and get a swing going because I have a condition called CMT. It's a hereditary peripheral neuropathy. It's affecting my feet. They're a little numb. And by the way, it feels just like I just took my ski boots off after skiing in 10-degree weather all day.
Mm-hmm. And that's it.
And that's it.
Yeah. And you don't think twice about it. You just don't care.
No. I think it's great.
I'd rather have them understand why I can't jog along with them as they're hurrying up a hill, or why I have to go slowly down steps from an elevated green or even in an arena or something like that. Why I always have to grab one a handlebar. Here's one for you. Since you're in Vermont, I'm sorry to do this to you.
Okay.
If I go to the Clearwater Beach, one of the top beaches in the world, there's very little surf. Nice little rolling soft waves, little drop off, and then a big sandbar.
Okay.
It doesn't work. I have crawled out of the beach with people wondering what's the matter with me out of the water. And I don't like that image. So I take a walking stick, and it's like a ski pole with a basket on the end.
Yeah.
And I use it to get in and out of the water. And people look at it and say, oh, he must have been injured. I say, oh, yeah, I was a paratrooper and broke my leg.
I love it.
But
great storytelling.
With the stick, you've got acknowledgement from somebody that there's something not 100% right with you. Last point, go get on an airplane and walk through the air terminal. And having a stick, people get out of your way, step aside, help you get on and off. The kindness in human spirit and people who look at somebody who has some kind of disability and needs that stick or something, they just want to be helpful. And you better tell them what's going on, and you better have a stick that tells them something's going on, or a stick or two, and that'll really make your life a lot easier.
Yeah. And that's just a great point, because as Lizzo said, a lot of folks don't want to talk about their CMT. They don't want to express their feelings. They don't want people to see them in braces. And at the end of the day, I do think the individuals on the receiving end can be very helpful, can be very accommodating, and as you referenced, can really make that situation a lot better.
You're absolutely right.
Thank you, Tom, for that.
Yeah.
I just love your spirit and your willingness to accept what's going on with you, and you're finding solutions. I do want to express my condolences for your brother, Michael. Michael died not too long ago, two months ago. And he was such a gentle, kind soul. And I did meet him, and he's had a lot of challenges. But from what I've discussed with you, I think it sounds like that his death was in part due to CMT-related symptoms. Can you talk a little bit about that?
Sure. Michael had a long downhill slide, losing his motoring skill. His favorite cane was a cutoff hockey stick with a lot of tape on the end of it that he could
grab. Yeah.
Character.
He wore some braces off and on, but his progression was much more rapid than me and fairly quick. He eventually became pretty much wheelchair and needed a hand to get up out of bed. It was affecting not only his legs and his feet, it was affecting his hands. He had trouble picking stuff up. He was already well into the big round handle spoons and things, but he faced it all with the humility and grace that Michael exhibited every place else in his life. As things got worse, he also developed some esophageal muscle atrophy, which shows up in some CMT cases, but not a lot. Mm-hmm. And any other neurological disease can affect you. So swallowing, talking, difficult, a lot of coughing and hacking, trying to clear his air passage. Michael had a couple of times where he was either sick or swallowed something wrong. So things would get jammed up in there. And eventually he passed away after an incident where he was hospitalized. And there was no reasonable recovery road at all. And as he deteriorated in the hospital in December, family came to his side and held his hand and wished him well. And off on the journey, he went to the next level. But he's maybe 8 years younger than me. And I don't like that part. If I've got the same, and I don't want to go there. And my younger sister has CMT, and she has a similar condition. She's assisted living, wheelchair, needs help, has the same talking problem, coughing. And she's got a wonderful family around her and plenty of help to take care of her. But once again, there are two reasons I feel badly for CMT affected people, why I'd like to be helpful to see if I could help them avoid what happened to my brother and my sister and avoid what's happened to me.
Yeah,
Thank you for sharing that.
Exactly. And again, sorry to hear about that loss, but it's also, it sounds like you've reflected on that and there's things you learned from that as well, which I always find is interesting. A question I like to ask too, I think about the number of folks that we've talked to in the CMTA community, and some of which in the presence of CMT can be very withdrawn. And it makes me think about your day-to-day life? And I always come back to the question, given CMT, what gets you out of bed in the morning? What drives you every morning where some people we hear that's it's hard for them to move forward every day or get out of bed in the presence of their CMT, even if it's minor symptoms and or more significant symptoms? So tell us a little bit about that. What gets your 2 feet on the ground every day?
You mentioned when I was publisher of the DuPont Registry. That would get you out of bed every day. We had at one time 120 employees. We had an active internet publishing business. Incidentally, I'm retired from that.
Okay.
The company has moved on with new owners. And
but just recently, right? It's just recently, like March of last year or?
Well, that's another downhill slide.
Okay. We don't have to get into it. I just, you know.
I actually left my formal position with the company as many as 4 or 5 years ago.
Okay.
But I stayed active. I got to avoid the one thing that employers don't like, and that's the annual review of health insurance.
Okay.
Oh, geez.
And of course, given the consideration that I have to be very careful about it, it was just agonizing when you're talking about increased costs and what you're going to do to your employees and their children. I don't have to do that anymore.
Right.
So I'm retired from that, but I'm running a series of small businesses and a digital newsletter for the Tampa Bay area. I'm involved with some family businesses. I got plenty to do. What gets me up in the morning? I want to see sundown. I want to get through the day. I want to go out and be productive. I want to end up at the end of the day feeling that I've accomplished something and gotten better rather than worse, not only health-wise, but accomplished business. I have three daughters, three son-in-laws, and seven grandchildren. And that's a big part of my life. I want to make sure that what I leave them is at least somewhat as good as what my father left me. And that's enough incentive for me to get up. And plus, I live in Florida, so the mornings aren't bad at all.
Yeah. That's a great response to that question.
Yeah, it is a great response. I don't know if this is appropriate or not, but do you worry about having passed the CMT gene on to your kids? How do you feel about, are you looking for CMT? Are you just telling them what signs to look for?
They're well aware of it. And the three girls are in their late 40s. So they're approaching an age when it started to affect me. All three seem healthy. They're all three very active. They don't show any early signs of progression. They know it's a 50-50 chance. I referred them to the CMT centers where they can get blood tests. They haven't quite gotten around to that. They're ignoring it, which is fine with me. I'm not going to force them. I don't want to put them in a position where, Dad, look what they found out because you annoyed me, so I had to do it. So they know. I worry about it with the grandchildren.
Sure.
I worry about it more with the grandchildren, but at the same time, the grandchildren, based on what you all are doing and some of the other people in the CMT research are doing, they got a good chance of beating this disease or containing it in a manner that would make their lives more productive. So,
and I'm just so appreciative that you're so open. Again, so many
it is.
People
it's fantastic.
Don't even tell their kids or they don't express it. They're fearful. And I just love, I think, just being expressive and accepting of this helps everyone and it helps us move along in the right direction.
Yeah.
So
yeah.
Congratulations on that.
Yeah, definitely. So tell us a little bit about, obviously, you're very active in business, but in terms of CMT and therapy, and what are the things that you do? We hear you play a lot of golf and walking, but tell us a little bit about that exercise type component that you feel is important.
Well, in the peak of the magazine days, I was traveling the country to car shows. So I probably was active at a car auction or show one weekend a month in the winter in the off season, two weekends in the shoulder seasons, and three weekends in the summer. A lot of times those are in big convention halls and buildings with concrete floors. And that was pretty good exercise for me. I can tell you when you were all done, you buttoned everything up and it was 10 o'clock at night. 6 o'clock the next morning came very, very quickly. The legs were pretty sore. But today's world, where I don't have the pressure to do that kind of traveling, I'm here. So I do a lot of walking. I work out with a trainer who is a specialist in training people to have more better toned muscles and muscle strength for playing golf. I do that 2 days a week. I work with a stretch trainer who's a little bit more into the whole body 2 days a week. I try to play golf 1 day a week. I do have a boat, so I'm trying to get on and off the boat. I have a 10-month-old Labrador puppy, so that's a walk there.
Oh my goodness. That's a lot of work.
In the summertime, one place where I'm really starting to feel the effects, muscle atrophy, is I'm an active sailor on a 16-foot fiberglass boat that is a round hull. It's a bullseye, which is a Herrschaft designed boat. fiberglass, and I've been racing that boat since I was 12. So,
oh wow,
fiberglass doesn't rot, so it's still good. But that's a lot of work when I'm on there. It's got a spinnaker, so I need a youngster with me to help me out. Other than that, I just try to eat healthy and breathe fresh
air.
I would tell you, fresh air is key. And I know you guys up north get locked in and it's tough on you, but even if it's cold, if you got a little bit of time to go out and stretch your legs, and this is as long as I want to sit down.
Sure. I love, oh, I guess he's done.
Yeah, I guess that's our cue, like, folks.
Okay, get off.
No, I do have a stand-up desk.
Good.
When I'm on my computer, I try to be standing up.
No, I love your self-care regimen. I think more people need, even myself, you're inspiring me to take care of myself more and spend some time, because you're like, oh, I don't really feel like it, but it's good for you. And it keeps you moving and keeps you young.
It's true. It's even, and Lizzo and I have talked about that, even kind of what I've been trying to roll in my routine is before you just jump out of bed, do a little bit of deep breathing, right? While you're making your coffee, because I like coffee, is kind of take deep breaths and do some stretches. And even in the winter, I may go out on the deck and just inhale that kind of cold, fresh air and take my 5 minutes to clear my head before I start taking on work and other daily activities.
You know, that's a regimen that I just started lately that is a little bit odd, I think, but makes a difference. When I get in bed at night and I'm lying down and I'm trying to slow down from the day, although I don't normally have a problem doing that, I can fall asleep pretty quickly. I will deep breathe, not in an aggressive way, but just to get plenty of fresh oxygen down in the bottom of my lungs to get fresh blood started out my system before I start that shallow breathing when you sleep. And then hopefully, you know, you get some deep breaths when you sleep as well. And that's really, really good for you.
Well, we did get the cue that Tom is done sitting. So I know. We're just kidding. In closing, as we start transitioning to the close, you want to ask Tom the last question?
Let me interject one thing, because this has been helpful to me and how my attitude towards life, and I think helpful to others. When I was in grade school in Wilmington, Delaware, in Tower Hill School, which was the private school to go to, we were all spoiled. There was a fellow at that school named Jimmy Lee. Jimmy Lee was the janitor. And I'm sure Lee was a short version for a long Italian. Couldn't have been a better guy. He had jet black hair, always combed back perfectly. His uniform was always pressed. It said Jimmy on it. He was always happy to see you. And if you dropped a piece of paper on the ground, Jimmy was always in sight. They would go pick it up and say, now, let's try to keep things a little bit tidy. Well, Jimmy was everybody's friend. And we were all coming from well-to-do families. I'm sure he lived in the old Italian neighborhood in Wilmington, probably took the bus to work. But his humility, honesty, openness, and spirit was just unquestionably unbelievable. Well, I left there in the ninth grade to go to prep school. But between all of my friends, older and younger, everybody knew Jimmy. Well, one year, they put up a plaque in Jimmy's honor at Tower Hill. I carry a little picture of that plaque in my pocket. And it has Jimmy Lee's philosophy. And this will help anybody through any crisis, no matter what. Jimmy Lee's philosophy was very simple. To look forward and not back. To look out and not in. To look up and not down. And to lend a hand. Well, do you want to know why I'm on this podcast? Jimmy Lee taught me.
Wow.
Oh, that is incredible. I love it. And the fact you carry that around, and it's a great reminder, right? When you pull that out. In terms of core values and how to live your life better and overcome challenges, which you obviously have incorporated. It's really impressive.
It's cool that it's one janitor, one guy in your school that is not a classmate could have such an impact on you. And you've absorbed that and taken it in his philosophy.
Well, Lizzo, I think not asking the question, Tom answered the question.
And he answered the question.
Ask, which is, what advice would you have for the CMTA community?
So that's
and
great.
I think that is fantastic.
On a more functional scale, it's either move it or lose it.
Move it or lose it. Totally agree. People who keep on moving, keep using those muscles, they are much better than those who don't with CMT.
Yeah.
Or in general.
Yeah, completely. Well, there you have it, folks. Hopefully you've enjoyed this podcast, and Tom has just given some great advice, encouraging individuals, stay positive. You can work through these challenges. You can have a better outcome. I love it. Continue to kick CMT as it can down the road. Just keep kicking it down the road.
So Chris, he's just kicking CMT's ass. That's what he's doing.
Really. I think that's what it comes down to.
Well, thanks to the two of you that made the effort to get people on the screen here that will will most likely help others deal with this condition and frankly deal with other conditions that you run into besides CMT, to learn more about it from other people who are experiencing the same. And people can probably find me on Facebook, Instagram, and every place else you pick up. Any questions, anytime.
Oh, gosh, that's really great.
You'd be a great resource for the CMTA community. So thank you for sharing that.
Yeah, thank you so much for sharing your family story and your story. Really appreciate it. And to be open to questions, that's fantastic. Thank you so, so much.
Awesome. Okay, thank you. I've enjoyed it very much.
So, hey, Lizzo, if someone wants to learn more about CMT and or to donate to our cause, where should they go?
CMTAUSA.org.
You got it. There's a lot of information on that website. So really, folks, go to the site. Save this as a bookmark. Ongoing information. We will continue to educate you. It takes a lot of money to fund research and in order to find a cure for CMT. If someone was so inclined to generously donate to our cause, how would they go about this, Lizzo?
Well, I have been told I sound like a broken record. But go to CMTAUSA.org.
Got it.
So to our listeners, do you have a good story? Would you like to tell your story on our CMT for Me podcast? Write to info@cmtausa.org and pitch your idea. We want to hear from you.
Well, folks, and in honor of our guest speaker, just a short clip from the boss, Bruce Springsteen's Pink Cadillac. Here we go. Oh, I love that tune, Lizzo.
Another that was a great, good
great podcast. So until next time, folks.
Take care.
Adios. Until next time.